Hey guys, welcome back to the DemCad channel. I'm here with the author of self-sufficiency book, When There Is No FEMA. Okay, Richard Bryant, welcome to the show.
Thank you, DemCad. It's a pleasure to be on your show, and look forward to chatting with you about my book and any other topics related to disaster preparedness that you might like to dive into.
Okay, so When There Is No FEMA, please explain the basis of this book. What it's about. Because to me, it seems like a guide for the everyday person, the normal layperson, to deal with a situation where there is no government help in a natural disaster or any type of disaster. What is this really about?
Well, there are those who have misinterpreted that title as being a bit of a political statement, and it's really not meant to be. One of the things I point out early in my book is that I try to stay away from politics entirely. The thought is that addressing politics during time of disaster is a waste of energy that should be used to survive. So the title is not a political statement. The title is really just a statement of fact. There have been some major disasters in recent history when the FEMA government agency was not there to help everyone out. And I would say this, that if you were to look at the charter of that organization, you would probably find that the charter excludes a big segment of society from their assistance, because that segment of society is typically covered by things such as insurance. So the fact that FEMA is not there to help is not a statement necessarily that the organization is not competent.
Yeah.
In the past, it hasn't been there. And when you have a disaster, you need to not count on FEMA being there as well.
So basically, the book could have just as easily been called When You Know What Hits the Fan. When you're pretty much on your own.
That is absolutely right. And the subtitle of the book is also important. The subtitle is Survival for Normal People in Very Abnormal Times. And a number of the books on survival are can almost be described as by military for military. And this book is really written to address the needs of those people who don't have the military-type survival background, and those people maybe who need to survive in a situation that's not a military situation. It could be a major disaster inside an urban-type situation where there is lawlessness, and when rule of law breaks down entirely, and really something that even our military is not accustomed to dealing with.
Because that's not really what the military is for. They're usually designed to deal with external threats.
Exactly. And a lot of there are some great survival books written by people with military backgrounds. They just tend to fall back on the military side of things, and survival is a much broader topic.
There's a psychological aspect of it as well. It's a lot more than a lot of people really think about a lot. So what really led you to going into this area? What led you to writing this book? What type of experiences do you have? Because for me, prepping is just something I'm interested in, and it's something that I strive to improve upon. I mean, what really led you into this area?
Well, basically, I've evolutions that led me in this direction. The first evolution, I'm 55 years old, so I've been around the block a few times. And my first evolution was as a teenager growing up on the family farm in West Tennessee, doing a lot of hunting and trapping and staying physically fit. Basically, I was the ultimate prepper without even knowing it. And in those days, I would go to the local Western Auto Store in my hometown and spend an hour just looking for fishing hooks, for the perfect fishing hook. So I, in those early years, I gained experience. I quickly put on the shelf, and I went off to college, and forgot about until fairly recently. Later in my career, I became a professional engineer, and I've worked in some major organizations. I've worked in NASA and for military organizations and so forth, and in those very technical world, I became pretty soon as a written communicator and strong at organizing thoughts, and gained mastery in some technologies that helped me to write a great book. So in this second evolution, I really gained some of the basic skills that could be used to successfully write a high-quality book. A third evolution took place in the year 2008 during the presidential election. And this was, and the catalyst for that, I'm sure you recall the Joe the Plumber episode.
These elections are always circuses anyway, but go ahead.
Yeah, well, you know, the whole theme there was collectivism. And I've always had in back of my mind the following, that the United States has historically been an engine of capitalism in the world. And that engine of capitalism may have propped up other countries. For example, if we have a military base in France, then our soldiers are spending money over there. Our businesses are buying their goods and services. So the U.S. as an engine of commerce maybe has propped up the entire world.
I've suggested things like that as well. I've sort of suggested that the reason why a lot of European countries have a lot more money to spend on healthcare and other social programs because they don't have to spend so much on defense because of NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. They receive a lot of military support from the United States, so they don't have to. Their governments don't normally have to cover the areas that they normally would have to cover if it wasn't for organizations such as NATO. The United States provided military support.
Exactly. And so when I heard about the whole Joe the Plumber thing and that the U.S. maybe is going to travel down that same road that the European nations have traveled down, I thought, well, who's there to prop us up? And the answer is nobody. And at that point, it just sort of started in 2008. It planted the seed in my mind that there may be problems ahead. And that seed is like a snowball rolling downhill. It grew. And it caused me within a couple of months to start a small group here in my hometown of Tampa that was related to disaster preparedness. And that group initially met, and we're just a tiny group. In fact, the first 2 or 3 months, my wife and I went to the meetings, and there was nobody there, literally. And it was really quite embarrassing to go to a meeting and have a big table reserved, and you're the only ones there. But that group grew at an exponential rate. And this was really... This was really my third evolution, which was in becoming an organizer of this preparedness group for a period of a few years. And as that group grew, each month I would prepare a presentation. So we would have a theme every month. We would have a meeting where we dealt with water, another one on emergency food, energy supplies, and there was always a topic. And I would prepare an agenda for those meetings. And I would prepare reference material for everyone. And we would draw into the group experts in various areas. We've had experts in solar energy. EMTs would participate. We had SWAT team members who would participate. U.S. Former Special Forces type people and people in law enforcement. So we had a great wide spectrum, including just regular people concerned about the security of their homes and their neighborhoods. And those meetings would last till 11 o'clock at night, from 7 in the evening till 11 o'clock at night, sometimes till midnight. So those people who were interested in preparedness were passionate about the topic. And these discussions went on and they went on. And as they progressed, I started to pull together their information and then to go and reinforce that with research on the internet. And so this led me to my fourth evolution. That group at one time was the largest preparedness group in the U.S. Today there are many around the country that are much larger, many that have hundreds of members. And by the way, I would invite your listeners, in fact, let me underscore this. I would invite your listeners, your viewers, to find a meetup group for disaster preparedness in their area, because I'm going to tell you, you're going to meet the greatest people and you're going to make the best friends of your entire life. It's almost going to be like you're a kid again, just because of the diversity of the people and the good nature of the people who participate in those groups. So I can't recommend that enough. And these groups are all over the U.S. So if you were to go to meetup.com, you would find literally hundreds of them spread across the U.S. In groups as small as 10 or 15 and groups as large as 300 or 400. So I want to mention that to your viewers because it's done so very much for my life. Before I started my first preparedness group, I was so buried in my work that I had maybe 2 or 3 friends in this world. since I've formed that group, now I've got 30 or 40 great friends, and they're sending me pictures of hog hunts they've gone on the weekends, and they've shown me pictures of shelters that they built, bug out shelters and so forth. And that group has spun off into several groups that have become even larger here in Central Florida. And that spinning off process took me to my final evolution. The final evolution was realizing that I was gaining a lot of really great knowledge and information, and having had that background in information technology and professional writing, I realized that I could do a lot more good if I could take all this information and pull it together into a book. And this takes me into my final evolution as an author of When There Is No FEMA.
Yeah.
And this took place over 3 years ago. So this is a book that required 3 years of continuous writing and rewriting and proofreading and reproofreading to put into existence. If your readers were to look at this book, I like to describe it as textbook quality. It's one of the few books that's actually I wrote it using the same tools that college professors use to write textbooks. So as you thumb through the book, what you're going to see is that it's like a textbook. It's got a 20 pages of bibliography in small print at the back, because I had hundreds of sources of information, and they're all documented in the book. It's got a full index in the back, so you can quickly find information, and it just has that look of a textbook, unlike many of the books on the subject. Since I put the book out, the first thing I've done is put copies into people. I just gave away free copies till it hurt, and I started to get feedback, and I would give copies to the organizers of these meetup groups across the country, and I started to get very good feedback. And there are a few things about the book that sort of set it apart from others, and I'll tell you the feedback that I've received.
Okay.
One bit of feedback is the amount of detail. I wrote this book as if I was writing it for myself to use in a disaster scenario, which means I was constantly asking questions. Is there enough detail? I can't just tell the reader you need to grow carrots. I need to say, what type of soil do you need? What time of year do you plant them? How do you weed them? What bugs do you protect against? How far do you space the seeds? How deep do you plant the seeds? Do you grow them in a greenhouse and then transplant them? What do I use for fertilizer? And what about fertilizer? I went into minute detail, and this is just on gardening. I did the same thing with raising rabbits and goats and chickens. And so one bit of feedback that I get is the extreme detail that I went into in the book, and that's because I saw that missing in the other books that I had read. The other thing that you may find that sort of sets this book apart is chapter 14 has been highlighted by a number of people who provided feedback to me, and it's a sort of an interesting chapter. What it does is it assumes the following, that you are prepared, but your neighborhood and your city is not prepared. And you don't want to just hole up in your house and wait for everybody to descend on you. Instead, you want to give your community a chance to survive. So chapter 14 provides a detailed list, an extremely detailed outline, I should say, for forming a disaster community at the neighborhood level or at the small town level. And this basically the thought is this. There's been a major disaster. Everyone's very nervous, and this is no time to come up with a plan. So chapter 14 is that plan, and it's a full charter for a disaster neighborhood. It includes everything from voting and who you vote for and minting currency and what is the basis for the value of the currency and how do you put currency in people's hands in order to immediately jumpstart a local economy.
Mm-hmm.
and who owns property and how do you amend the charter, which is really sort of a mini constitution in the future, so that if people don't like the way things shape up, they're guaranteed that they can change them after time passes and the disaster has settled out. So chapter 14 is a real how-to for an entire community to galvanize and to roll up its sleeves and recover from a major disaster.
Well, I had to check this out myself. Sounds pretty cool. Yeah, how do people get a hold of this book?
Excuse me?
How do you get a hold of this book? I want you to talk about the website.
The book itself is available through the website, which is nofema.com.
Okay.
And anyone who visits it, there's a link that lets you download the first 60 pages so you can see the table of contents. What you'll see is that there are virtually every aspect of disaster preparedness is covered in this book, and this is also the feedback I get. One word that was used to describe it is the word encyclopedic. I really like that feedback. And it covers communications. It covers even the exotic forms of radio communication, such as sending email by radio or real-time text chat by radio, as well as voice communications.
I didn't even know you could do that.
Absolutely. It also covers how you can personally purchase highly secure communications for tactical use in your neighborhood, because there actually are commercially available frequency hopping radios that give you a high degree of security.
Are they affordable?
They're portable. They're almost like the little portable FRS radios. In fact, they use the FRS radio frequencies. And it talks about ham radio and the role of ham radio. It talks about the different... I recommend vendors throughout this book. I don't have any commercial sponsors. So all of my recommendations are pure and not biased in any way.
All right.
So I recommend vendors for water filters and food supplies and communications gear and things of this nature. That sort of gives you a description of some of the content. If you want to raise rabbits or chickens, this book tells you how to do it to the last detail. If you want to hunt deer or wild hogs, or quail, or pheasant, or other animals, it gives it to you in the last detail. Once you've killed those animals, it tells you how to field dress those animals and prepare them for the freezer. So it goes into detail on everything.
Wow, that's pretty incredible. I've been looking at the news recently, and I've been seeing a lot of interesting things. What are some of the things that really concern you most, or some of the things that leave you the most optimistic?
One thing I can tell you is not just about me, but I can tell you about preppers in general. Because in my meetings, I ask for a show of hands on multiple occasions about the nature of disaster that preppers are concerned with. And 95%+, probably 98% of preppers are concerned with economic disaster. And I'm sure that'll probably resonate with a lot of those people viewing your YouTube viewers as well, because I'm sure this isn't just localized to Tampa. But there are other types of disasters that we need to also be concerned about. There are a large number of disasters. For example, a solar flare. It's a very real threat of solar flare. And I want to say it was 1859. I probably have the year wrong, but it's somewhere in that neighborhood. There was a solar flare that caused what was called the Carrington event, and it actually caused telegraph wires across the U.S. to melt. Imagine what that would do to the small circuitry in every electric car with electronic ignition. Imagine what it would do to the computers that control gas pumps so that they stop functioning. So now transportation systems shut down. And now we see this now when there's a storm, that groceries disappear from grocery shelves. Only now those groceries are gone for the long term. And we can see in other countries when the systems break down, you do end up with lawlessness on the road. So transportation systems don't come back overnight. So that's another example. Another good example would be a pandemic. Yeah, the Spanish flu outbreak in the early 1900s was an example of a pandemic that was almost like it was surreal by today's standards. I'm sure many people would have a hard time imagining that. There were spouses who would say goodbye to their husband or wife and go off to work in the mornings, and when they came home from work, their spouse, who was well when they left, had passed away from this disease. So it is possible that there could be diseases that would be every bit as devastating as an economic disaster, a Carrington event. There's the New Madrid Fault in the center of the U.S. There's the Yellowstone Geyser, which recently has been showing some very disturbing signs of activity. And the Yellowstone Caldera apparently is enough to obliterate, from everything I've read, about 25% of this country, to turn the middle of the U.S. into a dust-covered wasteland. And what does that do to transportation to the other parts of the country? So that's an issue. And of course, we're now talking about picking a fight with the other nuclear superpower in the world, and that has its own set of issues. So there's all sorts of disasters. The earthquake in Haiti that took place a few years ago,
yeah.
there were bodies and body bags that were being bulldozed into ditches. And this was just right off the coast of the United States. So there are plenty of there are plenty of disasters out there. You can take your pick. And we live in the nightly news reminds us that we live in a very unstable world. The leaders of the world seem to be playing on that instability in order to line their own pockets.
A lot of them are unstable.
exactly. And I don't know when all this is going to stop. So we're playing with fire, and the people who are smart will get ready for that fire. And it may not happen this year. It may not happen next year. But a lot of people, very intelligent, very mainstream people these days, are saying that there's a high likelihood it will happen this year or next year, especially in the case of an economic disaster. So everyone should be concerned about a wide range of disasters, and prepping is really just doing your due diligence. It's doing what we should have been doing for the past 20 years, and the reason there's a sense of urgency is because we're playing catch-up.
Yeah, people don't really tend to think about emergencies until there's an emergency.
Well, I'll tell you what. You know, there are a lot of people out there who believe that preppers are nuts and lunatics. But I'll tell you what I saw the other day on one of these little things they use to fill time on television. I saw a broadcast about the civil defense system in the U.S. back in the 1950s after World War II. And this entire nation was a nation of preppers in the 1950s. Now, if we're going to laugh at those people, and if we're going to mock those people who prepare today, then we're also mocking our fathers and our grandfathers and our great-grandfathers who preparedness was a way of life for them, and they had very serious concerns. And only a fool would not have serious concerns in today's world.
I couldn't agree more. All right. Richard Bryant, thank you for joining me. Thank you for sharing your knowledge. Guys, the book is When There Is No FEMA. So you can check it out at nofema.com. Thanks for watching again. Thanks for listening. And don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today. Bye.